All right, here we are underway. This is a time-shifted match, so in real life this is already finished, so we don't actually know what the result was. On the left there you see Tom Lapille. And Tom, you may know from his rather long stint in Magic the Gathering R&D. He was a developer, a designer. He worked on Dungeons & Dragons for a while. He's really kind of worked his way around the building down at Wizards of the Coast. And he has recently moved on to a different job, so now he can play competitive Magic again. And he couldn't wait. He's already played like three tournaments once so the way it works, Ben, there's a 30-day window after a new set comes out where he can't play because he might have worked on the set or have knowledge of the cards. But they figure after 30 days, the players have had enough time to catch up, and so he can play again, and here he is at the GP battling.
And we see this all the time. It shows you how much everybody who works for Wizards loves Magic. Very frequently, as soon as players are no longer working for R&D or working for the company, they just immediately start trying to play Grand Prix in the Pro Tour and whatnot again.
That's true. And I did actually have a chance to chat with Tom earlier in the day, and he said he described this deck, the Sidisi Whip deck, as buttery smooth.
It's an interesting description.
I was like, I don't know what you mean, but I took it that he liked it. So.
Yeah. I mean, it has a nice flow, I guess.
Yeah.
I mean, when it's working, I mean, it's definitely a good deck. It doesn't fire on all cylinders at all times. I mean, butter kind of does.
His opponent is Sean English, who is playing Abzan Aggro. And I got to say, Ben, I was out while you and Luis were in the booth for that last round, and I had a chat. I saw Shahar, I saw TBS out there, I saw Kibler, and I was just kind of poking around and asking people what they were running. And I met a few listeners from the podcast. What are you running today? And I got to say, Abzan Aggro is everywhere here in the early stages of the tournament, and that's what Sean's running today
as well. It seems like a logical choice. A lot of the decks coming out of the World Championships were going way over the top, so you wanted to play something aggressive. Meanwhile, it has Anafanzon Thoughtseize, so it's particularly good at disrupting these over-the-top CDC Whip or Black-Green Constellation, you know, just Abzan Whip decks, all these way over-the-top decks.
Right. So a nice start here for Tom. He had a CDC. She got Heroes Downfallen, but he's got a follow-up play with Farika. What do you make of Farika in this matchup?
I like Farika a lot. It's a threat that's very difficult to remove, and you know, a lot of your opponent's spot removal looks kind of silly after you just keep paying two mana and keep making more and more 1-1s, and then they can't use the removal well on those 1-1s because, I mean, you can make a lot of them. They're just individual 1-1 death touch creatures. They're only really not good against Bio Blade.
Right. Now, speaking of Bioblight, that's what Sean has in his hand, though. It's the only card left in his hand. And Tom Lapille is firing on all cylinders here. Goodness sakes, takes away the Wingmate Rock and kills his only threat by and even battles in there, leaving Sean top decking effectively with just a Bioblight in hands.
Kind of a buttery smooth game for Lapille.
You can see where he came up with that. Now, all of a sudden, things are just rocking and rolling. Now, he doesn't actually have a ton of direct pressure, though, on Sean. He's only got a zombie that's attacking right now. And there's a Thoughtseize, which was the only card drawn for Sean. So Tom will now know that the only card left is going to be a Bioblight. And Sean reads Soul of Innistrad. This is not good either way for Sean.
Yeah. You can't really make them discard Soul of Innistrad because they can still use the ability from the graveyard. What you really need to do is like Abzan Charm that guy or something when they cast it.
Right.
Exile it from the game. Sean is down a lot of resources here. He's really going to have to outdraw Lapille down the stretch. Pretty hard to get back into this game.
Right. There's the Bioblight. That's the last card in hand there for Sean English.
But now we're really going to see Farika shine.
Yeah.
The only thing I would say, Farika and Soul of Innistrad don't exactly have great synergy.
No, they do not.
But I don't think Lapilli's really that worried about it. He'll probably make some guys and then cast a soul, and then if the soul lives, that's great. If the soul dies, he'll be able to use it sooner or later to use its ability.
And of course, anything like a Satyr Wayfinder or a Sidisi off the top can just completely change that dynamic. Here's Abzan Charm, though, for Sean. Interestingly, he's going to draw some cards with it.
I don't know if I like this. He knows Lapilli's last card is Soul of Innistrad, right? Or
yeah.
Do only we know that?
He knows that.
He knows that. So, I mean, Abzan Charm is your answer to that.
Yeah.
I know he feels himself falling behind on board, and he doesn't have a ton of time because of the Farika, and that's all true. But, I mean, Lapilli can only make so many guys, and, you know, Sean would have outs to those with Bio Blight or something. I think I might have held on to that Abzan Charm.
Only one mana source away for Tom Lapille from just casting that
right.
Soul, which is going to close out the game on its own anyway. Like, you need an answer for it both short-term and long-term.
And other answers are most likely going to send it to the graveyard. I mean, Abzan Charm is your answer. That's what you wanted for it. So I think I would have probably tried to hold on to that Abzan Charm at least for a turn or two. If Lapille draws the land and plays the Soul, you're definitely going to rather Abzan Charm exiling the Soul than to have drawn two cards.
Right.
If he doesn't, then maybe I see one draw step, and maybe I draw like a Bioblight or a Siege Rhino or something that can basically bring me back on board.
And Sidisi off the top there for Tom.
Yeah, well, that would have been tough anyway. I mean, I don't know if I would have Abzan Charmed that or not. I might have. But either way, you can see how using it to draw two here doesn't seem that effective. It's kind of weird. If you have that Abzan Charm, you're almost hoping your opponent draws a land because you just want them to not draw another threat and play their land and slap down the Soul so you can Abzan Charm it. Sidisi, obviously not great because if you Abzan Charm that, they still have the Soul.
Right.
But, I mean, what are you going to do?
And maybe a zombie as well.
Yeah, I don't think Sean's really in a position. If you Abzan Charm the Sidisi with the trigger on the stack...
They don't get it.
Yeah, right.
you're correct about that.
Yeah, so I mean, I think if Sean had held on to it, he would probably have Abzan Charmed the Sidisi.
Oh, but he has a Bio Blight right now.
Right.
That's pretty nice. Now, the other trigger does resolve. He just doesn't get the...
The 2-2.
The 2-2's out of it. That's right. Yeah. So, not too bad here for Sean, though, like you said, he still does need to find an answer for Soul down the stretch. And also, his life total's dwindling pretty quickly here.
Yeah.
Oh, Wingmate Rock. Now, there's no raid here. This does help. I mean, the death touch on those tokens is going to be pretty annoying.
Well, he's not going to be blocking. It's mostly going to help in that he can gain some life mm-hmm. while he's attacking, because those are only 1/1s.
Yeah.
You can't grind through them, but if you can go around them, then they're not that effective.
Okay. So not too bad here. And see if Sean can keep... I mean, he's drawn pretty well. The Bio Blight was really, really nice.
Yeah.
All right, here's a Fleece Mane Lion. And he gets to send in there for 3 and gain a life as well, virtually mitigating one of those snakes.
Yeah, and if he can force Lapille to make a lot of guys because of the life gain from Wingmate Rock, then if he finds Bio Blight to clear out the team, maybe he can turn this game. I mean, Fleece Mane Lion's indestructible monstrous allows it to be pretty effective against 1/1 death touches, especially if it's attacking and the Wingmate's attacking and he's gaining life. I mean, we know that Soul of Innistrad is still lurking.
Right.
And we know that there's a team of 1/1s that now need to be dealt with.
Yeah, so Sean very much up against it still, but has at least put himself in a spot where maybe he can find a way out.
Maybe if he can really draw the right card each turn for a couple of turns.
Yeah, he's done that so far, but it's a lot to ask to keep doing it over and over. I guess a Bio Blight would be pretty incredible here, though.
Yeah, a Bio Blight would be really good. It looks like a Hero's Downfall from Lapille will pretty much seal it unless Sean draws Bio Blight, because if he doesn't get to gain the life from a Wingmate attack, then I just can't really see how he's going to stop 4/1/1s outside of Bio Blight.
Right. So let's see what he draws for the turn. Sean English all the way down to 2 life here.
I guess an Elspeth would be interesting. Does he play Elspeth?
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah, we have his list here. He's credited Brian Bronduin as the deck designer for this, so he got it from a BBD list.
He's got them in the sideboard, but he does not have Elspeth in the main.
All right, so this is game 1. Did he draw it? He did! He drew a Bio Blight. Wow.
Keeps on ticking.
That must be nice.
Yeah.
So he is still alive here. And the Hero's Downfall was used to take down the Wingmate Rock. So that means the Fleece Mane Lion is still left over. Can Sean actually get back in this, or is that Soul of Innistrad still too much?
Well, I mean, the Soul of Innistrad's still there. We know Lapille has a Hornet Queen in his hand. It's not like Lapille hasn't been drawing all land or anything. He's been drawing all spells, too.
Yeah.
I mean, if he hadn't drawn that Hero's Downfall and that Wingmate Rock was attacking now and that Fleece Mane could go monstrous and then he could gain 2 life, then maybe that would have been a game Sean could have won. Knowing that Lapille, like, that Wingmate Rock is off the board, so he can't gain life, Sean, and that Lapille has Hornet Queen in his hand and is only 1 mana short of it, I can't imagine how Sean's going to close this game out in time.
It's a tough spot for Sean. Rakshasa Death Dealer, though, is decent here, but he does ultimately need to get that Fleece Mane Lion to monster status That way, it can also stand in the way of the Soul of Innistrad when that eventually comes down. Like you said, the Hornet Queen's really the main issue here.
Yeah, and Sean doesn't know about that Hornet Queen, I don't believe.
No.
So, I mean, he might think, like, well, maybe I'm like not in a great spot, but I'm not that far out of it.
How many creatures does Lapille have left in his yard? He's going to take one out, but he couldn't have done another one even if he had it.
And it can't be that many. I'm not sure if it's, you know, one or zero, but, you know, he already made, what, four or five tokens?
Yeah.
It certainly can't be
no Hornet Queen this time, though. I got to say, Tom's playing very crisp here. He's, you know, when you're testing in R&D, you're not playing just to win like you are here at a GP. You're playing to analyze cards, to take a look at, you know, how the experience was. Was it fun? You know, is it too powerful? Is it not? Was it kind of boring? Did it need to be spiced up a little bit? But Tom...
Does that turn the Freak on? No, it looks like it's one short.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. No, it does, right?
Two, four, six, seven. It does. So maybe...
Maybe
attack,
I spoke too soon.
No, maybe an attack there with the Farika and the woman Death Touch would have been interesting.
That's what I mean. I guess it does just get regenerated, right?
Well, yeah, but he can't take the hit from the Farika.
No, you're totally right.
So it would kind of bounce with the Farika and he would take the one damage.
Yeah, one damage could absolutely matter.
It's not meaningless. I know you don't want to accidentally get 14. I think he's a little short of that, which means he can't happen. Right, it's only 11 on board, even if he could pump all the way somehow or something. So yeah, I think I might have found that attack. I'm not 100% on that.
It is interesting.
Yeah.
So now Sean's turn is to monstrous his Fleece Mane Lion and also be able to regenerate his Death Dealer. That will probably...
I think this is just game. I mean,
yeah, he's also just taking lethal that way, too.
Yeah, and even if Sean had had the removal, Lapille had the Hornet Queen.
Yeah.
Lapille had the Hornet Queen,
he even played it first.
Yeah.
Maybe just hoping for a concession. All right, so that was game one to Tom Lapille. Sean found himself behind, and while he actually ripped quite nicely to be able to not just be dead several turns earlier, he still had a lot more work to do, as Tom's draw was fantastic. Yeah, Tom lives in California now. He decided at the last minute to come down and play this, and like I said, he's quite happy with the list. He got some help from some of his friends down there. I know Vidyanta Wijaya helped him with the last few cards. VD probably likes Denver.
Oh, did he win the last GP Denver?
Yeah, he won the Legacy one.
I've been busting Pat Cox's chops because me and him work together a lot. And I was kind of 50-50 on coming to that Grand Prix, but I don't know Legacy that well. And Pat ended up playing the Jund deck that did really well. Joshua Rabbit's top 8 with him, as well as Pat Cox getting second. And, you know, when I asked him about the deck, he's like, you know, it's okay. You know, I don't know, you know. And he doesn't know Legacy that well either. And, you know, I don't think he knew it was great. But I think it was great. So if he could have maybe been a little more confident in the deck, maybe I could have came down here and won the last GP Denver instead of VD.
I mean, to be fair, that last match, if you guys have a chance to go watch it, it was insane.
Yeah?
It was, yeah. I still actually can't believe that that Pat lost. It was an improbable game, I'll say that. There was a, what was it? I think it was a spirit token or something that Vidi had made, and it attacked for like 12 or 13 or something. And this is against Jund. They can kill creatures like it will. But Pat just couldn't find an answer.
So I'm checking out their sideboarding. It looks like Lapille has just a variety of different interesting cards in his board. Ashiok's, Kioras, another Soul of Innistrad, Disdainful Strokes, Bioblights, a Reclamation Sage, just a little of this, a little of that. In this matchup, obviously his opponent's deck is kind of really in the middle. I mean, it's Abzan aggro. It doesn't play Seeker like we saw Lil J playing. But, you know, it's pretty aggressive. It's got the Rakasha Death Dealers, the Fleece Mane Lions, the full four Wingmate Roxo. It's kind of one of the more, I guess, high-end Abzan aggro decks. Still clearly the aggro version, though. So I'm not exactly sure if Lapille wants to have some stuff like Bioblights or not. He probably does. Deals with a few of the creatures. Maybe not. Doesn't really kill Anafenza or Siege Rhino or Wingmate Rock.
How does he do? Can he fire it off in the early stages? Like, if he has Bioblight, can he reliably cast it on turn 2, turn 3?
It's got a lot lot of black sources. I mean, obviously black isn't the easiest. Four Opulent Palace, four Land of War Waste, two Polluted Delta, two Swamp, two Temple of Maledi, Evolving Wilds, Mana Confluence, Urborg. You know, 16, 17 black sources.
Quite a few tap lands there.
Yeah.
It's just interesting because, you know, one thing that you'll see from Bioblight is, you know, since it costs two, you can use it to take out your opponent's two drops. It's super important against this aggro deck.
I think if I was on the draw, I might bring in the Bioblights.
Uh-huh.
I think on the play, I wouldn't.
Okay.
I figure on the play, I can just run my own Wayfinders and Caryatids, and I'm not going to be that far behind. And
you have a more proactive
play. Right, just focus on my game. On the draw, I probably can't let them go good two drop, good three drop into me, so I might want to go ahead and just have Bioblight answer their two drop.
Okay. That's always interesting.
And from English's perspective, he's got Glare of Heresy does nothing, Drown in Sorrow does virtually nothing, Back to Nature's pretty good, with Whip being one of the key cards of the stack. Not a ton of targets, but you know, you could certainly bring in two or three for the Doomwake Giants, Whips, and Coursers. Murderous Cut is a nice cheap removal spell, kills a lot of the big guys. Elspeth is decent. Not good against Doomwake Giant. So I don't actually think we'll see a ton of sideboarding by either of them, really. I know they sideboarded for a little while, but I think in the end they should only maybe switch a couple of cards. I think actually that might be a good concept to talk about. Sam Black once said to me, you know, do you think people as a whole would win more or less if they just didn't sideboard at all? And the reason he said that is because you think you're improving your deck when you sideboard, but people way over sideboard.
Mm.
More often than not, your deck, like the cards feed off each other, and it has synergy, you know, as a curve, as a plan. You can't just take out 8-10 cards every other match you play just because some of these cards seem a little weak in a matchup and the other cards seem better, because you disrupt what your deck actually does when you do that.
Right.
And it's definitely, sideboarding is definitely a bit of an art where you know, you want to do just enough that your deck still fully functions, and maybe you just pull out your weakest card or shave a little bit of your weaker cards. You definitely don't want to oversideboard.
Right. Yeah, we see that a lot, too. There's the discussion about bringing in a Silver Bullet, right, a card that is just fantastic against a certain matchup, where you're turning a card that might be a 1 or a 2 into a 10, you know, versus cards that marginally improve, you know, what you're doing, but might disrupt your deck, like you said. Like, I think one thing to do would be is to just take the deck list post sideboard and take a look and say, does this deck still do things, right? Does it still do what you want to do, or have you become so reactive that your deck doesn't actually, you know, function on the level that you wanted it to?
Yeah, the way Josh likes to say it, Josh Utterleighton, is that, you know,
I thought you meant Little J.
No, is that you know, you basically should be envisioning your post sideboarded deck. Like, you're not just pulling out your weaker cards and putting in your better cards. It's like you have a new deck post-sideboard.
Right.
And that's what you want your sideboarding to
do.
That's
a great way to look at that.
Yeah, you need to practice your post-sideboarded deck and make sure that deck also has good synergy and is functioning and is, you know, what you want to play in that matchup, basically.
Right. All right, so a little bit of action here early from Sean English. Since he's on the play, he went Rakshasa Death Dealer and then followed it up with the Siege Rhino, which immediately got killed. And here's Ashiok now for Tom Lapille, who is going to begin the shenanigans, and he's already got a target, in fact two of them there.
I don't know how much I love that. You know, Sean's deck's the more aggressive deck of the two. It's probably pretty good at attacking Ashiok. Ashiok's great against the really mid-range to slow Abzan decks.
This is nasty turn here. Do you see what Lapille just
did? Yeah, and I know Ashiok's going to be great here, but this is the game where, you know, you have the pretty much nut draw. You have everything you wanted. I mean, you drew a good curve, a Wayfinder, a Murderous Cut that you played for one mana in the early game. I don't think this is what you're worried about. I think you're worried about when your draws are slightly weaker.
This curve was insane, man.
Right.
Yeah, he went Satyr, Wayfinder, Heroes, Downfall, your Siege Rhino, then went Ashiok, Murderous Cut in
right.
the same turn.
I don't think this is the game you're worried about, but I think when your draw is slightly weaker, you know, the Abzan Aggro deck's pretty good at pressuring Ashiok. I don't think Ashiok's a card you really want against them.
Okay. Yeah, it looks like Tom has decided that he is definitely the control deck in this matchup, and he's going to start cashing in Ashiok almost immediately here to get a Fleece Bane line. He won't have white mana to get the monstrous ability going, but hey, he'll take.
No,
a free
I do
creature.
Like that, of course. I
yeah.
mean, free 3/3s on a clear board.
That's nice.
And I mean, Sean's deck can cast virtually all his cards with 4-5 mana, which he has. So Sean's hand's got to be pretty weak. He could have some removal with no real great targets. Obviously, he wasn't going to kill that Satyr Wayfinder. He can't really have any creatures because they'd be in play.
Right.
Only Wingmate Rock, I guess.
Wingmate Rock's the only one?
Yeah, if his last line was that temple.
If he does have a Wingmate Rock, he's going to know that his window to cast it is now, as there's a Disdainful Stroke sitting on top of Lapilli's yard. But Wow, Lapille also has another Hero's Downfall in hand. His hand is insane.
Yeah. Maybe if Sean brought in those Elspeths.
Okay.
He could slap down an Elspeth here. It'd be pretty good.
Oh, that would be nice. Although, again, Lapille with the Hero's Downfall does have an answer in hand for it.
Yeah.
Let's see what Sean does. He's got to do something big here. That's not it. He did leave that card on top, though, so something good is on the way.
Probably just a recap.
Rakshasa the Death Dealer?
Yeah.
Sure. I think Lapille can live with that. I mean, it's a fine threat. It will be able to pressure Ashiok, but...
It's a great attacker in the early game. It's part of the reason I don't like Ashiok against this Abzan aggro deck.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that at this point in the game it's going to be all that effective.
Oh. Wow. Tom Lapille attacked just to try to bait Sean English into using the green mana for his Death Dealer. And he did. He fell right for it. And Lapille just immediately snapped it off. And now Sean English has no threat going once again.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that play. That's not really a blowout. I mean, you save the damage, and it's hard for Hero's Downfall to do less than kill a Rakshasa Death Dealer. So,
he can play around it, though, right?
He's got a lot of mana, but, like, if he plays around it, Hero's Downfall is going to kill something else, and if he's using the Rakshasa Death Dealer, the Hero's Downfall is going to be able to kind of mess it up at some point anyway. I'm not saying whether he should have blocked it on that exact turn.
Another Hero's Downfall for Lapille, by the way.
But that would be a tough spot to try and play around a Hero's Downfall.
Okay, so it's better just to get it over with now.
It's weird, because when your opponent makes that attack, you know they're not bluffing.
Right.
So now that you're looking at it, I'm not sure if you actually want to block or not.
Okay.
But I don't think that he gave up too much by blocking.
Okay, I mean, it was ultimately a one-for-one, and he used mana when it wasn't on his turn. So, like you said, it wasn't a huge blowout. But it did put him very, very far behind, or I should say keep him very, very far behind, as Sean finally finds an answer for Ashiok, but the damage is done. A pair of Fleecemane Lions that Tom Lapille got effectively for free are now battling.
Yeah, I mean, those are going to have to be...
Just turn another Ashiok.
Those are going to have to be Bioblighted, or an Elspeth's going to have to come out, or something of that nature. Lapille is up all kinds of resources.
Yeah, just insane. His draw has been fantastic. And by the way, there's half your life total, Sean English.
And he's got plenty more to do. Lapille's now casting Ashiok. He's got Courser in hand.
This is just a runaway.
Yeah. This would take a pretty big swing from Sean. And usually a big swing involves big cards, but Lapille's sitting on Disdainful Stroke, so this big swing is going to have to come from cheap cards.
Well, on offense, it does get in under Disdainful Stroke.
It sneaks in at the last casting cost that can't be countered.
That's
and
right.
The biggest creature.
That's true.
It's bigger than the Fleece Manes, but couldn't be countered. Kind of a perfect card.
So actually kind of a big game here, as Lapille needs yet another removal spell to seal the deal here.
She doesn't have that. But he's still under...
He finds a Vile Blight.
Yeah, he's still under no pressure, and he's still sitting with that Ashiok, now a Courser.
He has a whip in hand, too. Mike, what a bloodbath.
He's got a lot going on. There's that Elspeth.
Two Planeswalkers, in fact. So he can just sit back for a turn here?
Yeah, I mean, he just played the Courser, so that couldn't attack.
Right.
Certainly not going to push your three guys just to deal the four damage here. Just wait the one turn, I think.
Now, does he want that Bioblight? Does he want to draw it next turn and
yeah.
then shrink down on Offenza?
Yeah, I would take the Bioblight because, you know, you run the risk of drawing a land that doesn't do pretty much anything for you, whereas the Bioblight gives you a nice attack next turn.
Yeah.
It's good enough.
Okay, a Rakshasa Death Dealer. Sean English continuing to fight. He really has hung in there, even though both games have been kind of landslides in Lapille's favor. Sean is at least... hung in there as long as possible, though it is hard to imagine that he gets out of this.
Yeah, I mean, his back is way to the wall. And the problem is, even though he might not even be attacked this turn or anything, he's not really gaining any ground.
It looks like Tom says, all right, well, if you're going to have that, I don't want my Bioblight anymore. I'm going to crack my Evolving Wilds and try to draw something else.
Yeah, I think that's a little greedy. You know that this game has the potential to go long, and you're up resources. You have an Ashiok you can protect. I think I'd be happy enough drawing the Bioblight. Certainly there are better draws than Bioblight. That was, you know, one of the weaker spells probably Tom could draw. But rather than risk drawing a land or a Wayfinder or, you know, a Caryatid or something, I think I would just take Bioblight there, you know?
Yeah. He drew Bioblight.
Is that justice or is that like the opposite of justice?
It's the opposite of justice.
Yeah.
And then he hit a land under it too, because that's how this game works. And there's another one too. All right. It does feel like Lapille is just sort of in the how do I feel like winning this game mode.
Well, he's certainly in the driver's seat. But I mean, imagine English, Bioblade's with us, there's Fleecemane Lions.
Okay.
He may have an attack on the Ashiok now.
Okay. No, you're right. Yeah, that could actually absolutely change it. Especially because Death Dealer is such a threat.
Yeah,
card is nasty.
Clearly, Lapille's up resources now. English has to outdraw him down the stretch to be able to win. It's not impossible.
Right. All right, here's Sidisi, Whip of Erebos. And he's just going to pass the turn, but Tom's going to get a Wingmate Rock next turn.
They really need to kill that Whip. I mean, the Anofenza is going to maybe mitigate it, but the creatures already in the yard are still coming back, right? Well, they might have been removed from Murderous Cut. I'm not sure. Does Lapille have creatures to whip back?
He probably doesn't. Anofenza's been out for a while.
And Murderous Cut removed any of those. The early stuff, right?
Yes.
Anything that went right away?
He did, yes.
This is
so
interesting.
There's a pretty good chance that he doesn't have much food. So those aren't going to go to the yard.
Maybe he drew another Anofenza?
He just decided to trade it off for two for a Fleecemane and a...
It's an interesting attack if it was for no reason. I would assume he drew Wingmate Rock or Anofenza or something, some reason to attack with it. It's not a horrible attack. It just... Why do it?
But yeah, there's a question in the air here. What are you up to, Sean English?
Yeah, like, there's no reason to do it. I mean, there are reasons that can make you do it. I would say if you didn't have one of those reasons, you wouldn't make that attack.
Right. He's left himself with just the Death Dealer currently, which he just... Oh, he had Drown in Sorrow? Yeah, I saw him pump up the Death Dealer. What does this actually do?
I don't understand.
He's just getting Scry?
Didn't the 4-4 trade for a 3 and a 1-1? I mean,
yeah.
He could have ordered the two Fleecemanes first so that he would have killed one and put one on the other one.
Yeah.
And then the Drown would kill this Fleecemane.
But he didn't.
It doesn't look that way.
Oh, that was a mistake.
Died.
I think that's what he wanted to do, but he just messed it up. Yeah, because the Wayfinder died. That would have died to the Drown
and
Sorrow.
And that would
have
made perfect sense. You know how I said, like, this attack isn't far from right. Like, if you have a reason, but you wouldn't do it for no reason. That would have been a good reason.
Yes.
If he could have, because now that Fleecemane would be gone, too.
That's a shame.
Yeah.
He would have had exactly this board state, but minus the Fleecemane. Yeah, I think that Sean saw that play, but just didn't quite sequence it out right as far as how to order the blockers. Maybe got in a little bit of a hurry there.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. Because that Rakasha, you know, can threaten this Ashiok. I mean...
Yeah.
I mean, Sean would still certainly be an underdog, but... Yeah.
I mean, remember, Sean's at 7.
Yeah.
Huh.
Now I think Tom, if he had nothing, I think he would just grab that Wingmate. Obviously, he's got the Bioblight, and Sean knows it. Just nothing Sean can really do about it. So he's going to grab that Wingmate and trigger the raid, and that's going to actually do it. Even Elspeth or some of the more powerful draws, I don't think really come into play now.
Especially with how poorly they match up against Wingmate Rock, or she matches up against Wingmate Rock and Friend.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if he triggered the raid or not.
Well, he should have.
Yeah, he can, and he should.
He might just be getting a token.
Yeah, it looks that way. It looks like he's reaching off.
Don't bother, Tom Lapille. You are the winner this round. Sean English has to extend the hand.